What's up, guys? Nathan here. My last video about underrated uniques got some mixed feedback, to say the least. But most of it was positive, so I figured I'd do a sequel. If you haven't already seen that video, link is in the pinned comment below. In said video, I explained the fundamental differences between rares and uniques, so if you're not really sure what all that's about, just check out at least the first minute or two of that episode. However, the too long didn't watch is that uniques need to provide a lot of power for their price or a completely unique benefit to be worth using over comparable rares. Today, I aim to introduce items that fit into either or both of these categories yet remain inexpensive or underutilized based on PoE.Ninja. Basically, by the end of this video, I hope to have given you guys a nice handful of new items worth considering for all those fun snowflake builds I know some of you like to play. So, without further ado, let's jump into the video. The first item that I have for you guys today is Choir of the Storm. Now, I'm sure some of you guys remember this item back from its glory days and pre-3.0 before it was nerfed, and what it used to do is it used to give you a small negative 30% lightning resistance, and in turn, it would scale up your critical strike chance based on your uncapped lightning resistance. Now, this was very powerful because, as you can imagine, it's very easy to get huge amounts of lightning resistance all over your gear. Suddenly, your gloves are basically, or your boots, your gloves, your belt, all these things are providing up to 45% increased critical strike chance just by virtue of how this amulet let you scale up your crit. So that was removed. Now it caps at 75% or whatever your lightning resistance cap is on whatever build you're playing, and most people decided to ignore it since then. However, what a lot of people don't realize or maybe remember is that the proc, this level 20 lightning bolt that it deals every time you crit, can deal a pretty substantial amount of damage. For one, it's 2500 base damage on a 0.5 second cooldown. For reference, Stormcall, which is a, you know, not the beefiest, but a pretty reasonable lightning damage spell, deals around 580 lightning damage at level 20. This can really be scaled up very hard, this 2500 lightning bolt damage. You can scale this with spell damage, lightning damage, critical strike chance, of course, crit multi. And for my cast on crit arc build, which is the only build that I've used this amulet for, it was hitting for around 95k at the end of the day, which is no joke, especially when you factor in the fact that I was always critting, so I could consistently get it off whenever it was up, and then I had some cooldown recovery speed because I was a cast on crit build, which in the end factored into being around 250k DPS coming out of a single choice of my gear that wasn't a weapon. An amulet alone was giving me 250k DPS. Now, obviously, there are some cases, especially with melee builds, where you're going to be able to get a lot more than 250k DPS, but for a caster build, this specific case, it was a huge DPS gain for just a very cheap, unique, easily anointable amulet. However, this item does have some downsides. I just want to go over those really quick. One has like zero defensive benefits. Honestly, if you're not a mind over matter build that's on the cusp of being on the proper ratio, you're really not going to get any defenses out of this amulet. And then two, you need to be scaling lightning damage and consistent crits. So you need to be playing something like cast on crit, some kind of, you know, ball lightning build to like really get the most out of this amulet. Otherwise, you're really not going to see the crazy offensive benefits that it can bring for its low cost. Next up, we have the criminally and classically underrated Voidforge. Now, anybody who's seen a Mathil video before has probably heard of this item, but hey, I love it too, so I'm going to rave a little bit. First of all, huge damage when scaled correctly. That 300% of extra, or 300% of physical damage as extra random elemental damage, that's huge. If scaled properly, you're going to be hitting very hard. However, I think the item also has some really interesting utility benefits. First of all, 20% increased AoE on your weapon. You're not really going to see a lot of weapons out there that give this much AoE and also this much damage. It's a very unique trait. You can also shock fairly consistently if you're playing a build that synergizes with Voidforge correctly. I don't think this is that exciting of a line because you could just roll lightning and then shock anyway, so I don't think it's like that big of a deal, unlike Starforge, where it is actually pretty interesting. And then there's also the up to 100 life on your weapon. There literally is no other example other than Starforge of a weapon that gives up to 100 life and then actually gives you like good DPS at the same time. So as far as I'm concerned, this is a benefit worth considering. Really quick, I do want to talk about how to scale this weapon here, because even though Mathil has gone over it 100 times in his videos, I just want to point this out really quick. I'm talking right now sort of just off the dome, so forgive me if I get this a little bit wrong, but basically what you do, you pull up Voidforge and Path of Building when you're ready to start theory crafting with it. You go in, you edit the item, you edit the unique, and instead of having it say gain 300% of weapon physical damage as extra elemental extra damage of a random element, I think is what it says. You need to copy and paste that down three times, change the 300% number down to 100%, and then you need to edit that so that it says gain as extra fire damage, gain as extra lightning damage, and gain as extra cold damage on each of the three separate lines. This isn't going to give you a perfect idea of what you're going to be doing, because obviously sometimes you'll go fire, sometimes you'll go all cold, sometimes you'll go all lightning, but it will give you a nice average look at what your DPS looks like. And then once you've created this, custom made Void Forge that actually interacts properly with Path of Building, you can drop it in, slap on your Herald Purity, slap on your Steel Rings, and start seeing what kind of damage this item can actually do. However, this item does have some downsides. I should talk about those for a second. First of all, although it does have great damage potential, like really you can clear all content in the game with this item, it does have limited end game scaling options when compared to one-hander builds. Really, this is just because, you know, Paradoxica and Savior exist, but also at the same time, just one-handers in general have absolutely insane end game scaling. And then of course, I mentioned Mathil a couple times, so you probably already know this, but every time he makes a build with this item, well, unless you know how you have a lot of currency laying around, don't really expect to easily pick it up, because it is literally every Mathil effect flipper's favorite item. He's even trolled people with it before by keeping it in his inventory, watching them buy it all up, and then just deleting it before actually using it in a build. So just watch out. Don't use it at the same time he does, and don't really expect to be hitting those crazy, 20, 30, 40 million DPS numbers that people with Savior, Paradoxica, Impale builds are hitting. Next up, we have the Searing Touch. Now, this is not a very flashy item. It's not an item you're going to see in a lot of streams or whatever, but it is a very simple and effective one, and I figured this would be as good of a video as any to talk about it. Really, all it is at the end of the day is an Ignite caster weapon for skills like Flame Blast and Fireball Ignite Prolif. It gives you literally everything you need. Gem levels, fire damage, and fire damage overtime multiplier, and these are literally best in slot stats for Ignite caster builds. It is also very, very cheap currently. It's only one Chaos if you just want to pick one up unlinked for some reason, and it's only one Exalt for a 6-linked version as well. And it's also because of this one Exalt price, even though that does seem a little bit pricey, but we are talking absolute min-maxing here. You can also Corruption Hunt very efficiently with it. Basically, every time you make an Exalt, you pick one up, you slap a Vol Orb on it, and then, hey, maybe you hit something like Supported by Inspiration or whatever. There's a lot of interesting options you can do with Corruption Hunting. I've talked about it before. I won't belabor the point, but I think the Searing Touch is a excellent candidate for doing so. Really, overall, it's just a solid staff for the price, and that's why I think it belongs in this video. And the only downside that I can think of, maybe there's another, is that +3 or up to +5, technically, rare staves can beat it in terms of just raw DPS, but just cost-wise, like that is a crux of why so many uniques end up getting used, is because they're so cheap relative to the power that they provide. So really, just because there are rares that beat it, I don't even think that's a significant downside. Just a great item. Go play Fireball Prolif, Ignite Prolif. It's great. With this staff, you'll have a good time. It'll be cheap as hell. Trust me. Next up, we have the Skin of the Loyal, and I consider this basically a luxury Tabula. Now, that's not 100% accurate, but I'll try to explain that a little bit later when we get to the downsides. First of all, let's talk about the pros of this item. First of all, it has +1 to socketed gems, which can be a huge damage boost in some cases, especially for caster or minion builds. Melee builds, not so much, but you probably shouldn't be considering this item anyway because it doesn't have any life on it. And it also gives you 100% increased global defenses, which varies quite a bit in value. But for things like, CI builds or hybrid tricksters, this can actually provide a significant defense increase. It's not going to be as good as some insane 700 ES, redeemer chest or whatever, but it's still pretty significant considering you're getting that +1 socketed gems as well. It also has a divination card that gives it called the Price of Loyalty. Now, I'm not going to explain this divination card too in depth because it is kind of quirky, has some interesting tricks to it, but the creator of it, Sergio G, made a whole video about it back when it was first coming out, and I will try to put that in the description below so you can check that out and understand why the Price of Loyalty is a really cool divination card that allows for some unique double corruption hunting in a way that you normally wouldn't be able to with any other item in the game. However, there are some downsides on this item. It is not all sunshine and rainbows, as is the case for everything on this list. One, you cannot change the sockets in any way whatsoever. even if this item is not corrupted, you can't change the sockets. Why is that? I don't know. That's just how it's balanced. That's why this item isn't overpowered. It drops the way it drops. So if you're playing a build that needs, you know, two blues, two greens, and two reds, you have to find a skin of the loyal that already has these exact colors for you. It also doesn't have any life on it, and this is pretty obvious, but you really shouldn't be considering this anyway. If you're playing a life-based build, this is much more oriented towards ES or hybrid builds. And then the last thing is the extreme price variant. And I think this is because people realize there's some builds that really hone in and can get a lot of value off this. Specifically, I played an Essence Drain build, and if you're trying to find a specific color variation with a specific double corrupt on it, seriously, we're talking like 30, 40 exalts. But I mean, if you're not super interested in that, or you're playing something kind of niche, people don't realize how strong it is for your specific snowflake build. You can get it for, you know, 30 chaos, but that's what extreme price variance is all about, and that's definitely a drawback as far as I'm concerned. Next up, we have Marilene's Fallacy. Now, this item may not seem like much at first glance. It's got some weird stats on it. It has a big old drawback. It has a big old boon, but it's really hard to tell exactly when you'd want to use an item like this. Let me preface a little bit before I get into the benefits of this item by saying crit in this game is really easy to come by these days with things like Assassin, Scion, Bottled Faith, flat critical strike chest. It's so easy to push into that 90, 95, 99% chance to crit. But that's not always a good thing, because you push to that level of crit without wanting to invest in it at all, and then suddenly you realize, wow, I now have to avoid crit on all of my gear. It is literally a dead stat that should be anything else to actually be useful. And having dead stats when you're trying to gear and think of scaling opportunities is not something you always want to do. This amulet completely solves that by being the fallacy that it is, by reducing your critical strike chance, giving you a huge less multiplier. 40% less is nothing to scoff at, while giving you a massive amount of crit multiplier, which is going to be much harder to have access to. And basically, in some cases, when you're pushing these 99%, 95, 90% crit builds, suddenly, Marilene's Fallacy is going to push its way to the top in terms of your POB DPS sorting because of how much crit multi it gets, and then how much it opens you up to build more crit on your gear. Because suddenly, if crit was a dead stat and then you equip this amulet and crit is no longer a dead stat, you can start considering all kinds of different roles on your gear, and you can rescale yourself and suddenly become a crit build anew while having access to this insane damage multiplier. It also gives you free coin strike, and overall, you really have to test it on a build-by-build basis, but there are a lot of cases I think you'll realize where Marilene's Fallacy is going to be an absolute best-in-slot damage choice. It does also have the benefit of being cheap for corruption hunting. I brought this up before. I won't go into it too much, but 1C, and you can just slam as many Vol Orbs on this thing as you want, get things like increased Hatred Aura effect, increased Zealotry Aura effect, of course, maximum res. There's a lot of good stuff you can get on amulets. Does have a few downsides. I probably don't even have to go into them, but clearly things like flat evasion, accuracy, and light radius, especially in the quantities that are on this amulet, are kind of borderline useless, basically niche stats at best. And then there's basically no other survivability on it to speak of. We're talking no life, no resists, nothing crazy to write home about. However, at the end of the day, if you need a best in slot damage amulet, you got to keep your eye on Marilene's Fallacy. It can very quickly reach a competitive state if you're scaling your crit like a madman. In a blast from the not-so-far-away past, we have the awesome wand Shimmeron. Now, a lot of you guys will probably remember Shimmeron from the Incursion days, back when Arc Totems, Arc Mines, Arc Traps were all the rage. Shimmeron was fantastic for these things, because basically you would get the absurd amounts of damage scaling available via Shimmeron, but you would have none of the downside, because all of that self-damage went to your totems, or went to your mines, or your traps, so you wouldn't actually have to experience any of the drawbacks of the weapon. So, when they changed that, they nerfed the damage a little bit, but they did make that self-damage go directly to the player. People became a little bit disenchanted with it, myself included. However, I want to give a shout out to Modded in my Discord, because he started to make me realize the other day how insane this item still is, and it should be considered for a lot of builds. First of all, the lightning damage, crit multi, spell block, all that stuff is absurd. You're not going to get damage stats like this, or even the defensive stats of spell block, anywhere on a rare wand for anything close to the cost. It's around 2 chaos right now for baseline rolls, and that is not half bad for the amount of damage this thing gives. More importantly, this is a source of base crit, which is a difficult to come by stat that lets you do things like scale crit for your herald device and explodey chest explosions. I probably don't need to go too much into this, because that's how auto bombers work, as they need to scale these things, but Shimmeron lets you do that. And I think more people need to realize that that's a specific aspect of the wand that is very unique and should be considered. The downsides of this item? Well, for one, you need some kind of power charge generation. Obviously, you're not going to have power charges for free just by using this weapon, but you do need to figure out a way to get that into your build if you want to take advantage of the weapon. And there's also the very obvious drawback that you are going to be taking some lightning damage. If you only have 3 power charges, you're going to be taking 600 lightning damage per second every time you crit. You're always going to be critting, and this translates to around 115 lightning damage per second after lightning resistance if you have that base 75% lightning res. That's really not a big deal. You know, you can mitigate that via leech or natural regen, but once you start stacking up those power charges, it can get a little bit dicey. But hey, as far as I'm concerned, having access to all of that DPS and that base crit makes these drawbacks absolutely worth it and should be considered more, especially at the 2 or 3 chaos price point. One of the very first builds that I ever made myself was back in Bestiary, and when I say made myself, I mean literally from scratch, just tried to do my own thing, was using the entire aspect of the crab set because I thought it was really OP and good, and of course it wasn't as good as I thought it was, but point is, the chest itself is actually pretty strong and I think merits a spot on this list. It is called Cretion's Carapace, and it is an absurdly defensive chest with some interesting quirks. First of all, it has 120 flat life, up to 120 anyway, and this may not seem like a big deal in the grand scheme of, you know, elder chests and belly of the beasts and that kind of thing, but 120 flat life on a unique is actually relatively high and should not be scoffed at. Next, it has over 2600 armor at 20% quality, and with good rolls and up to 28% or even 30% quality, you can get even more armor, and this is nothing to scoff at. If you are a build that's even remotely scaling armor, you're going to really notice this. This is a huge bump in physical damage reduction against hits. For comparison, this is literally the most armor you can get compared to any other chest other than the brass dome or an absolutely perfectly rolled glorious plate with armor rolls on it, specifically on a rare, which is not something you're usually going to be going for anyway. Next up, we have bleed immunity, which is maybe not seeming like a big deal since you can get that on flasks, but if you look at it on the flip side, maybe that means you no longer have to run a flask with bleed immunity because you can get away with having it on your chest, and that opens you up to run different kinds of survivability, different defensive layers, or maybe even more DPS flasks or more utility. You also get Aspect of the Crab with a couple of extra maximum crab barriers, and this isn't even really the biggest selling point of the chest because you can get Aspect of the Crab pretty easily on a chest just by crafting it on, but if you do choose to utilize this, then it's going to reserve a little bit of your mana, and every few seconds or so, you're going to have the ability to tank a massive physical damage hit to the face. I think at maximum crab barriers, we're talking an extra 30% physical damage reduction, which is a huge deal when it comes to tanking big hits. So if you're smart and you dodge most things, but sometimes something does get through, this is going to be that defensive layer you need to prevent from getting one shot. It also has decent resists, up to 60% total res, which isn't really a big deal, but for uniques, usually when you decide to include a unique, you're going to have to make those resists up elsewhere because uniques don't tend to have a lot of resists. However, in the case of Cretion's Carapace, you are getting a nice amount of res. However, this item does have a couple of downsides, as you can probably guess. One, has basically zero offensive stats, unless you kind of want to look at the bleed immunity as a pseudo offensive stat and how you can sort of reallocate your flasks. And it's also not dirt cheap. A lot of the items on this list are ridiculously cheap for the power they provide. However, this one is around 20 chaos for bad rolls at the time of this leak. And that's a little bit unfortunate because some of these items are ridiculously cheap. This one is going to set you back just a little bit more. And then Aspect of the Crab itself is, in my opinion, kind of a con just because the mana reservation, 25%, not always easy to fit that in. And then the inconsistency of Aspect of the Crab, because if you get hit multiple times really fast, you're not going to have that mitigation. It's really only going to work out for you if you're a very skilled player and you rarely get hit, or if you're doing some kind of boss encounter where you know you're only going to get hit, maybe really big hit, but every so often, then it's going to work out. But it's not consistent in all situations, so I would consider Aspect of the Crab more or less a con. Next up, we have Malachi's Artifice. Now, this is a ring that I think it got reworked semi-recently, but it's been more or less on the fringe of the meta for a while now, but it's never really been popular enough to work its way into the limelight, and I think that's a bit of a mistake, because for one, this item has the potential to be more damage than any other ring slot in the game, depending on your build. Basically, if you're playing an elemental build and you don't have access to good, you know, negative resistances or elemental penetration, Malachi's Artifice will get the job done for you. It basically lets you slot in any gem, and that gem will gain the effects of elemental equilibrium. So if you put in a cold gem and you use that, then that's going to apply the additional cold resistance, but all of the negative fire and lightning resistances to whatever enemies you hit. So very strong overall. If you're not 100% sure how EE works, basically that's going to give you a lot of extra damage of any element that is not the element of the gem that you put inside of it. It is also literally one alchemy, and I would tell you it's good for corruption hunting, but you really don't want to corrupt unset rings. That's not smart, because if you corrupt an unset ring and you change the implicit, then you're going to be losing out on that socket, and that's really... Trust me, it's not going to be a great ring. The big downside of this role is, one, it doesn't really bring anything to you other than a little bit of offense in some cases, or a lot of bit of offense in some cases, and then also getting the right resist so that you're not putting yourself in the hole with the resist just a little bit is going to be also kind of a big deal, and I think some people do tend to price accordingly based on whatever small streamer has decided to pick up and use this ring in recent memory. Next up, we have a bit of a weirder weapon, and it's kind of been punished a little bit by power creep over the years, but it is still in a decent place and can really fit the role of a more budget two-handed mace build for a lot of cases. Let's take a look at some of the unique aspects it brings. First of all, it brings in hits can't be evaded, which on its own is actually fantastic for two-handed maces, because those are going to be probably the most difficult class of weapon in the game to get the accuracy you need to not be missing all the time. However, the drawback that it gives you in exchange for this hits can't be evaded is crits don't deal extra damage. So right off the bat, you're kind of limited in your ultra late game damage scaling. Not being able to crit means you're never going to be able to hang with the big boys in terms of serious damage. However, one thing you can do is, because even though the crits aren't going to deal extra damage, you are still going to deal that crit. So if you full convert and you go elemental overload, you can reap the effects of elemental overload without having to worry about accuracy all. So you win some, you lose some, you kind of have to invest in converting, but that's not too bad, especially if you're playing something like Glacial Hammer or Ice Crash that's going to be giving you half the conversion for free anyway. Some other interesting aspects of the weapon that sort of further feed into the notion of it being some kind of unique budget weapon is, one, you get a significant amount of free resists, which, you know, in some cases can make the difference between being capped and uncapped. You also get onslaught every time you crit. I think it's for the next 4 seconds if you crit recently, and this may not seem like a big deal, but the weapon is very slow, so any amount of free attack speed can really make the difference in whether or not this weapon feels good to play with. If I were going to recommend some kind of build to play with this, I would probably play some kind of full fire conversion Zerker or Chieftain, or some sort of full cold conversion with Glacial Hammer or Ice Crash, like I mentioned earlier. But really, you want to get converted over and you want to go elemental overload, or I think the damage on this item is really going to suffer. Another upside, and this kind of plays into the sort of corruption hunting theme that I've always brought up over and over again, is the fact that the weapon is only currently 30 chaos for a 6-link. Of course, that is mostly due to the fact that Metamorphs kind of just spit out 6-links this league, but 30 chaos for a 6-link means if you wanted to make a build around this item right now for the end of the league for some reason, hey, you can hunt for corrupts or double corrupts. You could get things like supported by fortify, supported by inspiration. I think supported by onslaught probably exists and probably isn't very good on this weapon, but hey, you have options. It's cheap and it opens you up to build damage or survivability in a lot of other places. The downsides on this weapon, because trust me, it is not without one, is, one, the DPS is just horrendously low for a two-handed weapon. Obviously, I've talked about the upsides and downsides, but at the end of the day, it is a little bit of a lower DPS weapon, and the lack of attack speed really does hurt your end game scaling. We're talking like, I think it's 1.25 base attack speed, and onslaught, of course, is a global buff, not a local buff, so you're not going to be bumping that up to like 1.3 or whatever every time you proc onslaught. And mace wheels in general, I think this is actually the biggest drawback of the weapon, is that maces are just kind of not in a great place, I think. Like, a lot of the wheels do give a good amount of damage, maybe some AoE, some utility, but you're not going to get great attack speed scaling. You sure as hell are not getting fantastic crit nodes unless you go out of the way for blacksmith clout. So overall, it's a really cool weapon, can really give a lot to niche builds, but this is not going to be the end game damage powerhouse that I think some of you may be looking for. Next up, we have one of my favorite items in the game, and that is the Tempest's Binding. Now, a lot of you guys who have been playing this game for a while will definitely recognize this, because this used to be a very meta item back when Kinetic Blast was an absolute tier one skill for both dealing damage against single targets up against a wall, and of course, you know, dealing insane clear speed. It also is still fantastic for Delve, but overall, Kinetic Blast is not quite the powerhouse it used to be, and the Tempest's Binding, which came out back in Harbinger League, was a perfect fit for the sort of dual barrage and kinetic blast setup that a lot of wanders were using. Basically, it gives you a pseudo 6-link of a helm, which gives you ice bite and enervation. That's going to give you a lot of lightning damage and chance to shock every time you kill enemies, and then a lot of cold damage as well as frenzy charges every time you kill, I think it's like shattered enemies, which is going to be happening if you're playing with the Tempest Binding. It also gives you access to the Harbinger of Storms, which is a weird little immortal minion that you have to remember to summon every time you log in, and it basically applies free shocks and free chills to nearby enemies. These kinds of shocks are going to be the default value of 15% increased damage taken, and the chill is going to be the default value of, I want to say, 20% reduced action speed. It might be like 10%, but it's really about the shocks, because that's going to be helpful when you're trying to do single target damage with a barrage setup that's using LE focus, and you want to get those shocks in for free as well. This item actually used to be very expensive, like hundreds and hundreds of chaos. I think when it really hit its peak, it was going for upwards of 1,000 chaos, but now it's a little bit lower and it's only around 20 chaos to get an uncorrupted version. And in my opinion, that is an absolute steal for the power and versatility that it can provide. I'm a little bit biased, I will admit this, because I really do love the idea of having a separate setup for clearing as well as single target, but I do think more builds, especially builds that are scaling specific amounts of LE stacking, should be considering this helmet. The downsides, of course, not without those. It's going to be difficult to get your enchant. I don't think I addressed this on my first video very clearly, but it's going to be difficult to get enchants that you need on unique helmets, especially niche unique helmets, because people are not going to be enchanting those. They're going to be enchanting their hubris circlets or their lion's pelt or even some armor bases. So you're not going to be able to easily get some kind of tempest binding enchant if you really, really need it. And of course, Ice Bite and Enervate, very specific and niche as to what kind of builds actually utilize them. So, you know, you're just going to have to figure out whether or not this works for your build. Overall, it's a fantastic item. It's on this list for a reason, but you just have to really put in your research and make sure it's worth including. Cerberus Limb is a scepter that I kind of went back and forth as to whether or not I wanted to include on this list, but the more I thought about it, the more I sort of found it appealing and how it had some unique aspects to it, so I decided to include it. One of the main things that I really like about this weapon, outside of the obvious defensive utility, is that it gives you up to 20% cast speed, and this may not seem like a big deal, but if you're playing an Ascendancy that doesn't have great access to cast speed, I don't know, for example, like a Scion or an Occultist, you can get a lot of cast speed on this scepter, and it can make self-casting feel so much better. It also has a lot of interesting defensive utility. I think this is the main thing that draws a lot of people to it, but just to point that out, you can get some nice Iron Reflexes synergy if you want to do something really quirky, like a Max Block Blade Vortex Gladiator. You can convert a lot of those stats over and get a shit ton of armor from your shield, or you can do some sort of Trickster Evasion Energy Shield type thing. That also has a strong synergy there, because how it converts and gives you a little bit of extra secondary defense scaling depending on what you have on your shield. It also gives you Spell Leech. This is a stat that has sort of different amounts of value depending on what kind of build you're playing, but it is definitely a unique stat. You are not going to find Spell Leech very easily on main hand weapons without sacrificing metric fuck tons of damage. And you are losing a lot of damage by using this weapon, but it has other benefits, so it's not the end of the world. It also gives you a pretty decent spell damage roll. This isn't exactly a huge pro in my opinion, just because you can get a lot more spell damage and a lot more offensive benefits by using a rare, but it's not a huge deal. I still think overall this item provides a lot of utility and is definitely interesting and unique enough to be considered in some cases. The downsides, really the only downside of this weapon, it is kind of ZDPS when compared to the other main hand options you have available, especially when we start getting into rares, nicer rares, almost mirror tier rares. This item really starts to look like a, something that's going to slow down your build and keep it from one-shotting those bosses that normally would probably one-shot you if you didn't kill them first. So maybe not the absolute best endgame option, but provides a lot of utility and is definitely really unique and should be considered for more builds. Next up, we have another classic, and that is the Ichimonji. And I want to do a quick shout out to Irva Urgel. He's a smaller content creator that I just discovered the other day. And basically, I watched a little bit of his video as a Bladestorm Slayer using these weapons. And he basically just reminded me this weapon existed. I totally had been sleeping on it, especially with things like the Savior and Paradoxa sort of dominating the one-handed meta. I forgot how powerful and potent the Ichimonji can be when built around correctly. Basically, it is a very cheap one-handed sword with pretty terrible DPS and crit, but a very high attack speed stat, which again, that sort of just factors into the DPS, so it's not a huge boon in itself, but it really helps in the quality of life. A lot of builds feel much nicer when you're using a sword with good base attack speed. It also has the very unique line of 10% increased effect of buffs on you. I actually, off the top of my head, I'm not sure of any other sources of increased effect of buffs on you, but I can promise you, as far as weapons go, you're not going to find this anywhere else. This includes so many different things, such as auras, obviously, added damage you would get from heralds, Even like quirkier things like Blood Rage attack speed, Golem buffs, Fortify is considered a buff as well. So you're going to get increased effective Fortify. Basically, having access to this stat, especially if you dual wield them and you get two of them, so 20% increased effective buffs on you, is going to open up so many build options, from LE stacking to pure physical to aura stacking on just all kinds of different ascendancies. And really the best part of this weapon, as you can probably guess, is it's pretty cheap. It's only 5C for decent rolls. And this is coming off, you know, Urva's guide coming out, and probably more people thinking about the weapon than they normally would be. The downsides of this weapon, it is kind of awkward to build around. I've kind of noticed a lot of these trees, if they tend to stack up a lot of auras and they try to benefit from a lot of heralds, you're going to find yourself stretching yourself all over the tree to get yourself a lot of that reduced mana reservation. A little bit frustrating, but definitely possible to build around. And because of that, you're going to be a little bit lower on the life side, unless, you know, you're some Scion with really impressive gear and lots of reduced mana reservation. You can afford to invest into all of those life nodes that you really want for your build to feel good. Overall, great sword, fantastic damage potential, maybe a little bit of awkward to build around, but definitely worth considering, especially if you're on any kind of budget at all. Next up, we have one of my favorite items in the game, and of course on this list, and that is the Peripeteia. I don't know how to say that. I think it means like a sudden reversal of fortune, according to the Google definition I looked up a couple days ago, but I don't quite remember. Either way, it's a weird ass shield with a funny ass name, and trust me, it is really cool and should be considered. First of all, it gives you more attack speed, more cast speed, and more movement speed than literally any other shield in the game. This alone, I think, should be making people consider it more often. Up to 20% in all three of these stats, this can be a huge deal, especially movement speed. You're not going to find 20% movement speed on any other shield. That's an absolutely unique stat. Maybe you can get something similar by looking at implicits, maybe some sort of weird corruption thing I don't know about. Maybe I'm missing out on some new, conqueror mod that I'm missing out. But on its own, this is going to be easily one of the very best ways to get movement speed on your offhand slot. It also gives you a very solid amount of energy shield and evasion, which, you know, is kind of niche in some cases. But for example, if you're playing something like a hybrid trickster, which I brought this up a couple of times this video, but it's still relevant, you're going to be getting a lot of defensive merit from this shield. It also gives you the interesting stats of socketed lightning gems and mana. Some cases it's going to be useless because those are kind of like weird niche stats, but in some other cases it can be a very big deal. Mana can actually mean something. Lightning gems, if you're putting like just a Herald of Thunder set up in there, that can main a lot of damage. It also gives you access to the Lightning Aegis, and this is a pretty unique mod. Obviously, there is the Fire Aegis and the Cold Aegis and the Elemental Aegis, but if for some reason you're interested mostly in mitigating lightning damage, you know, this Aegis is going to get the job done. You're going to be basically immune to lightning hits as long as you're not literally like taking a bath in like an Eradicator Lightstorm. You'll probably be just fine. It also has potential for very overpowered implicits because it is a synthesis item. I'm not going to go too far into this one. I know you can get some cool stuff like minimum charges, but it's not really fair to analyze a synthesis item based on the OP implicits you can get, because let's be honest, we have zero control over what kind of implicits drop. So you're going to have this thing on live search. You're going to be waiting a very long time if you want something specific. The downsides of this item, because it is, of course, not without those. One, has no life on it. This can be a deal breaker for life builds that are trying to run a shield for more survivability. And the interesting downside on it that you've probably noticed by now, just looking at it up on the screen, is that the lightning theme means it has absurdly variable rolls. We're talking everything is between like 1 and 20. 1 in 75, 1 in 3. It's very difficult to get perfect or even just above average rolls on this thing because there's such amount of variation. Luckily, you're not always going to need all of the stats. Like mana has a lot of, you know, varying value across builds, so you might be able to ignore that. Attack speed and cast speed are very different stats. I can't really think of any build where you're going to specifically need both of those. And the movement speed, you know, that's probably going to be the most important stats. You'll probably want to focus on that one anyway. Overall, very unique and fun item. Just you got to think about whether or not it really fits in your build. If it does fit, trust me, it fits, feels great. If it doesn't fit, well, you know, that's what uniques are for. You move on, you think of something else, or you switch to a better rare. The last item that I have for you today is Hyone's Fury, and this sword has a lot of cool stuff going on. First of all, if you just look at it from a pure stats perspective, it is literally the second highest DPS unique sword in the game, or one-handed sword, should I say. The only item that beats it is Rebuke of the Vol, and Rebuke of the Vol is very awkward to scale, has a lot of chaos damage, a lot of physical damage, damage from all kinds of different elements. So at the end of the day, I would say Hyone's Fury is much easier to scale with its pure lightning sort of flavor. It also gets a nice increased lightning damage roll if you invest into frenzies. This is very important. I honestly think this is kind of the crux of the sword. You do need to invest in frenzies and potentially dual wield these if you really want to get the maximum amount of damage out of it. It also gives you a little bit of sustain while mapping, and that 20 life gained on kill kind of may seem like a bit of a meme stat, but it's per frenzy. So if you have three frenzies and you're dual wielding these, suddenly you're getting 120 life on kill. And if you kill a whole pack, well, anybody who's played with Trickster, Patient Reaper understands how strong it is to be kind of low, maybe a quarter life, maybe half life. You kill a pack, you're instantly full life without even having to think about your flasks. It's a very strong stat when stacked up properly, and I think you will definitely feel it when playing with this sword. It also costs only one elk, and I know I've sort of belabored the point of corruption hunting, but you can get some cool stuff on this. You can get chance to gain fortify on hit. You can get some local attack speed, some local crit. It does have that global accuracy implicit that may be important in some cases, but maybe you corrupt one and don't corrupt the other. You have options. It's very cheap, and that's sort of the appeal of corruption hunting. It opens up your build to more possibilities. The downsides, obviously the sword is not perfect. You're going to be taking some increased damage. If you're in hardcore, this is probably an instant turn off. Just, you know, move on, dead item. But if you're in softcore, maybe it's not the end of the world. Maybe you don't mind taking a little bit of increased damage. Maybe you die once or twice, but you're clearing the map and killing the boss much faster than if you were working with your 50C budget and trying to find a rare sword that fills the same void. It does also force you to invest in frenzies. And this is a bit of a double-edged sword, in my opinion, because frenzies are great to invest in. Who doesn't like, you know, increased attack and cast speed and more damage? But it is just an additional consideration that maybe you just didn't want to invest in it for whatever reason, and now suddenly you feel yourself a little bit punished because you're using this sword and you have to find a way to fit in frenzies. Otherwise, the sword is just kind of a meme item. And then the very last downside, even though it does have extremely high DPS for a one-hander, it is kind of slow. There are a lot of skills in this game that do not feel fantastic unless you dump a lot of attack speed onto them, and having a slower sword with slow base attack speed is going to make it that much harder to make some skills that, you know, aren't Cyclone or whatever actually feel kind of good. And that's gonna about do it for me today, guys. Thank you so much for watching. I'm sorry this video probably ran a little bit on the long side. At least it feels like it really stretched long, probably longer than the first one, but I really enjoy talking about uniques, and it seemed like you guys were really interested to hear what I had to say in my first video, so I decided to go full force in on this one. If you have any questions about any of these uniques, don't hesitate to leave me a comment, and if you're interested in getting another sequel, because there are other good uniques in this game, believe it or not, or you're interested in a video about overrated uniques, which is something I suggested in the first place, let me know in the comments below. It'll totally get read, and I will totally consider all of your suggestions. Either way, thank you guys so much for watching. My name's Nathan, and I'll catch you next time.
Thank you!
Thank you so much to my fantastic Patreon supporters, Real Human, Zikrak, Squally, Zoljan, Coda, Julia Allen, Kepler, Sparky Kata, Putzak, Heiser 801, Kyle Logan, Ice Dude, Ginzink, Anonymous, Orangina, Marius, and Alex. Welcome, Alex. Welcome to the Patreon team. Thank you so much for supporting me. Thank you so much to everyone else, too. You guys are all awesome. You make my life very bearable in a lot of ways. Seriously, thank you, guys. If anyone else is interested in supporting me on Patreon, you can check me out at patreon.com/NathanBrotherBob, or if you have a spare Twitch Prime laying around, I also stream every Tuesday, Thursday, and Saturday at 2 p.m. Central Time, and you can just, you know, drop by at twitch.tv/NathanBrotherBob, and you can drop me a little bit of a Prime sub there, so you don't have to pay any money, but I still get to make some money. That would be a cool exchange. Now, how great would that be? If you don't have anything to support me with dollar-wise, then you can just join the Discord. That also is a cool way to sort of just take part in my community, regardless of whether or not you have spare cash, because, you know, money isn't everything, and community kind of actually is when it comes to YouTube. So feel free to drop in on that Discord there, bottom right-hand corner, if you want to chat with me, my community, ask questions about Path of Exile, you know, debate, just have a good time. It's a good place. Love my Discord. You guys are all awesome. If any of you guys who are in my Discord, regardless of whether you support me on Patreon, if you're watching right now, thank you. You guys make my life really great. Like, actually, thank you guys so much. Okay, I'll talk to you guys next time. Bye.